Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we're about to commence this session. Professor the Honorable Earl Morrison, our distinguished awardee, distinguished members of the faculty at home and abroad, other delegates, ladies and gentlemen, it's for me a special honor and privilege to be asked to read the citation to confer the Sir Phillip Sherlock Distinguished Award on Dr. Henry I.C. Lowe. Sir Phillip Sherlock could arguably be described as the region's most outstanding folklorist. His interest in Caribbean ethnomedicine informed many of Dr. Lowe's research activities. He insisted that vigorous scientific inquiry should be used to determine the products in our indigenous plants so that we can use them safely to promote the health and well-being of our Caribbean people. Therefore, we could have found no one more suitable to give this award to than our awardee this morning. Dr. Lowe's stellar academic career began over 5 decades ago, having completed his junior high school education at Calabar, from which he graduated with distinction. He then migrated to Excelsior for higher education, followed by an interesting academic pathway from the University College of the West Indies, London, BSc Honours, the University of Sydney, MSc Pharmaceutical Chemistry, and Manchester University, England, PhD in Medicinal Chemistry. His penchant for the natural sciences and his lifelong quests for knowledge prompted him over the years to pursue numerous postdoctoral fellowships in pharmaceutical analysis, technical education public health, analytic methods in food medicine, technical research management techniques, complementary and alternative medicine. And in 2009, he gained a diploma in international law, University of London, United Kingdom. His academic appointments to date speak to the depth of scholarship which has characterized his life. And one can just provide for you a brief synopsis of his career pathway. Head of Science Department and Lecturer of Pharmaceutical Chemistry, rising to Vice President and Director of Academic Development and Research, College of Arts, Science and Technology, now UTEC. Consultant to a number of international bodies, including International Development Research Council, Canada, Pan-American Health Organization, Developmental Science International, Massachusetts, USA, Organization of American States, Science and Technology Development, Caribbean Community, Commonwealth Secretariat on behalf of the Organization of Eastern Caribbean States. He was President and CEO Blue Cross Blue Shield of Jamaica Limited and Permanent Secretary and Director of Energy Government of Jamaica. He is currently Adjunct Professor in the Department of Medicine, University of Maryland School of Medicine, USA. Advisory Committee Member, Center for Minority Research Training in Complementary and Alternative Medicine, Morgan State University, USA. And recently was appointed as Adjunct Distinguished Professor of Ethnomedicinal Chemistry, University of Technology. He's founder of the Environmental Health Foundation, Jamaica, Pelican Publishers Limited, Jamaica, Educational Enterprises, Jamaica, Biotech R&D Institute Limited, Jamaica, and co-founder of All American Institute of Medical Sciences, the first offshore medical school in Jamaica. His special research interest is indigenous Jamaican medicinal plants, primarily to identify their bioactive principles, as well as their potential for pharmaceutical, nutraceutical, and cosmeceutical potential. And since 2005, he has been pursuing a groundbreaking research in collaboration with Dr. Joseph Bryant at the University of Maryland in a project entitled Research and Development of a Jamaican Plant Extract as a Cancer Drug. He has received numerous honors and awards over the years, the most notable one being 1959 Government of Jamaica Exhibition Scholarship for Science, 1974, double awardee of British Commonwealth Scholarships under the Scholarship and Fellowship Plan to Sydney, Australia, and Manchester University in England. 1979, Institute of Jamaican Centenary Award for contribution to science and technology in Jamaica. 1982, Commander of the Order of Distinction for contribution to the development of science and technology nationally and regionally. 1988, Government of Jamaica Fellowship, creating software for scientific research and development. 1995, Super Lion Award, Science and Technology, Chancellor Hall, University of the West Indies, Mona. 2006, Jamaica Observer Business Leader of the Year for application of science and technology to development. 2008, Pelican Award for outstanding work in the field of science and technology, University of the West Indies. 2011, Universal Negro Improvement Association Marcus Garvey Award for contribution in the field of industry. And 2012, Caribbean Community of Retired Persons 50 Living Legacy Award. He's the author of over 150 publications in a variety of periodicals, referred journals, and non-referred journals, along with the popular press. He has either authored or co-authored 23 books. He is the owner of the following patents: anti-tumor and anti-inflammatory extracts of two indigenous plants from Jamaica, isolation and characterization of the antibacterial metabolite 2-acetonyl-3,5-dihydroxyl-7-methoxy-1,4-naphthoquinone from cylindrocarbon species, mechanism for the synthesis of 2-acetonyl-3,5-dihydroxyl-7-methoxy-1,4-naphthoquinone, patent filed 2008. Ladies and gentlemen, the University Diabetes Outreach Program is therefore proud to confer on this distinguished scholar, scientist, researcher, and pioneer in ethnomedicine, the Sir Phillip Sherlock Distinguished Award for outstanding achievement in the field of science and technology. So therefore, it gives me great honor to give this plaque and this citation to Henry I.C. Lowe. We'd now like to invite you to pause and remain seated as Dr. Lowe will present for you a paper entitled Anti-diabetic Caribbean Plants, Natural Remedies and Their Future Potential in Diabetes Management. Could you give him a UDOP welcome?
Mr. Chairman, Dr. Alveston Bailey, members of the health and scientific community, colleagues, other distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I'm indeed very delighted and humbled to be selected by the UDOP 2012 Planning Committee to give the Sir Phillip Sherlock Distinguished Lecture. In addition, I'm particularly honored to be the recipient of this prestigious award. The history of my career was interestingly captured and presented in a very profound way by Dr. Bailey, and I thank you, sir, for making these kind remarks to me. As was pointed out, my primary research focus at this time is on the identification, isolation, and synthesis of anti-cancer biomolecules from indigenous Jamaican plants for the development of nutraceuticals, pharmaceuticals, and to be used mainly for the contribution to the management of cancers. Indications are that some of these biomolecules may be useful in the management of other chronic diseases. Notwithstanding my various technical activities and interests, I have a passionate interest in contributing to the management of diabetes. Like me, everyone in Jamaica knows someone who is affected by diabetes. This disease has increased significantly over the years and is now considered to be pandemic in Jamaica and the wider Caribbean, as you'll hear later. As such, greater urgency is needed for its effective management. It was at the UDOP conference last year that the subject of today's presentation was conceptualized. It was felt that there are several Jamaican plants which have been used traditionally for their anti-diabetic properties and fully researched, but all these research data, most of which are very, very elegant and important, have been left on the shelves and in thesis, and nothing have been done with them. The tradition of a variety of plants used for the treatment of diabetes has been recognized by the local scientific community, not recently, but in fact, well over 50 years ago. And at that time, and since then, a lot more very important work has been done. However, until recently, no products have been made, and in fact, no clinical trials have been done on any of our potential drug products. As a result of this, a decision was taken to carry out an extensive review of the Jamaican and other Caribbean plants with known anti-diabetic properties through sound scientific validation. And secondly, to identify those plants used traditionally in folklore practices which are being used without proven scientific or clinical validation. This action, we decided, should lead to a book which would be published and launched at this year's UDOP conference. I'm therefore very pleased to announce and restate that this action has now been realized. On behalf of myself and co-authors, Professor Errol Morrison, Dr. Percy Bahadur Singh, and Dr. Cliff Riley, we are pleased to state that this book is definitely a unique Caribbean publication, which, as you have heard, is entitled Caribbean Herbs for Diabetes Management, Fact or Fiction, and published by Pelican Publishers Limited. I want to take a very quick minute to point you to a part of the statement in the title of the book, Fact or Fiction. And it is important that we note this because in the folklore, there are many things which are treated and are being treated as factual, and there's no evidence for this. So what we think might be fact might just be fiction. And of course, there are things which are there, which have been looked at, clearly identified as having scientific merit, but also need to be taken to the next level, which is the clinical trials, before they can be used in any widespread way. I wish to note that significant contributions were made by Professor Winston Davidson, past president of the Medical Association of Jamaica and head of the School of Public Health and Health Technology at UTEC. He did an excellent job in writing the foreword for the book, where he specifically addressed several important issues related to diabetes and ethnomedicine. And we were particularly delighted to have Professor Albert Rees, a foundation and continuing supporter of UDOP, who is also Vice President of Medical Affairs, University of Maryland, and Dean of the University of Maryland Medical School, and many other titles, who was very involved in determining the title of this book, as well as the caution given about not substituting herbal medicines for conventional medicine. Ladies and gentlemen, my lecture this morning is therefore built on the decision to review and evaluate the scientific work that has been done in the Caribbean, as well as the folkloric plants used for the treatment of diabetes and to determine the way forward. I think it's always useful when one is giving a lecture which is broad-based to get the audience to follow and understand where one is going. And very quickly, I'd like to tell you that the next section of my presentation will be looking at, first of all, a little bit about Sir Phillip Sherlock and why the lecture has been structured in such a way. The next one will be looking at biomedicine and ethnomedicine. The third section will look at what I call the burden of diabetes. We have heard it, and we have to keep on saying it because very often it's not recognized as such. And also want to look at some issues which are important about diabetes, which we have been overlooking. And finally, I want to look at the potential alternative diabetes management through plant products, and then outline what I consider to be the way forward. But before I proceed, I'd like to point out and remind everyone that Sir Phillip Sherlock is a scholar of great pedigree. And for this, it is important to know that I'm particularly pleased that I'm associated with him in this award. Sir Phillip Sherlock was a Jamaican who has been described as a complete Caribbean man. He was also one of the fathers of West Indian letters, with a tireless and scholarly interest in all things West Indian and Caribbean, and in particular, our folklore traditions. As an eminent Caribbean scholar, he was esteemed as a historian with a great passion for folklore. He was either author or co-author of around 15 books based on Caribbean folklores. And one of these, which is very well known and used in schools even today, is Anansi the Spider-Man. And we know about the cunning of Anansi. And we could say some more about that. However, it could be said that the lecture would benefit his interest as a folklorist, as well as one who tried to make folklore beneficial in a practical way to Caribbean people. The lifetime work and sterling dedication of Sir Phillip to Jamaica and the Caribbean is indeed remarkable, and I'm truly honored to be bestowed with this award in his memory, and do hope that this lecture will result in the evolution of folklore medicine to modern medicine, as we will hear in this lecture later on. So, Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, as background to this lecture, I think it's very important for us to understand the relationship between ethnomedicine and biomedical practices. And I don't know that I need to elaborate on the meaning of these words. I think we're all aware of these. However, I need to point out that the past 50 years have seen the social sciences bringing a new understanding to the study of illnesses and diseases, as well as to the medical systems and therapeutic regimes developed for treatment. Biomedicine is often viewed by most physicians as the panacea or cure-all for all ailments. However, scholarly research and the WHO, World Health Organization, have successfully challenged this view. The current views have had important implications for public health educators who implemented programs to promote health and prevent diseases. The findings of social scientists have revealed that health-related behaviors are primarily influenced, and in many cases, even entirely determined by social and cultural factors. So what I'm saying in effect is that despite the fact that scientific work and clinical work are critical in the use of traditional medicines, traditional medicines do have a place, especially in the developing countries, and more will be said anon. It must be recognized that ethnomedical systems have been the source of healing for people for millennia. This is where we evolved from. However, their effectiveness has been considered unimportant by many biomedical practitioners. Some of these biomedical practitioners are contemptuous of the role played by ethnomedicine in healthcare, although in some cases the contempt and concerns are fully justified, since issues related to dosages and toxicities are unavailable, and very often we get what are called charlatans, as well as some ethnomedical practitioners or so-called ethnomedical practitioners who give their clients, and I'm not calling them patients, but their clients, herbal remedies or medicines which could sometimes be downright dangerous because they are used as substitutes for modern medicines. More anon. It is for this reason, more than any other, that physicians need to better understand the nature and role of ethnomedicines and, where possible and appropriate, develop what I would like to call a complementary system to deal with the relevant healthcare issues. Globally, ethnomedical practices and beliefs are part of a total belief system that transcends class, ethnicity, religions, in such a manner that the term folk can be used to describe practices that are truly universal. In North America, Europe, as well as in Jamaica and other countries, the return to the natural aspects of healthcare is not restricted to the poor, but extends to all social classes, including the so-called well-to-do. Several factors such as accessibility, cost, cultural and linguistic barriers, and uncertainty about diagnosis contribute to stronger reliance on ethnomedicine and or its parallel use with biomedicine, which can be referred to and is referred to as complementary medicine. The World Health Organization and many healthcare scholars are recommending the contribution of ethnomedical practices to be associated with biomedical systems in a measured way, based on evidence, which could strengthen the delivery and effectiveness of healthcare. This clearly is a very big challenge, and a bigger challenge for healthcare planners today. And this challenge is of particular importance to the management of diabetes, where ethnomedical practices are very entrenched, and I'll be saying more about this later on. It might be of interest to look at the historical milestones in diabetes discovery and management to see how folklore practices may have helped in the development of modern medicine. I wish to point out here that for over 2,000 years, diabetes has been recognized as a devastating and deadly disease. It's not recent. This matter is not of recent origin. It's over 2,000 years. In the first century AD, a Greek physician, Artaeus, described the destructive nature of the affliction, which he names diabetes. So the name diabetes is not even new. It goes way back from the Greek word siphon. Physicians like Artaeus in ancient times recognized the symptoms of diabetes, but were totally powerless to effectively treat them. Artaeus recommended folk treatment with substances like oil of roses, which we found later had no use, which is where the fiction comes in, dates and raw bitter wood, which were prescribed. As late as the 17th century, doctors prescribed doctors prescribed broken red corals, sweet almonds, and blind nettle for diabetes management. That was what they had at that time. But of course, now we know they were of no use. But in the ethnomedicine, the folk medicines, it was accepted. Coming closer to today, in the 17th century, a London physician, Thomas Willis, determined whether his patients had diabetes or not by sampling the urine. What he did was to taste the urine. I don't know how he did all of that, but. And when the urine tasted sweet, he called his honey urine. This method of monitoring blood sugars went largely unchanged until the 20th century. So we are saying roughly 100 years ago, this type of thing went on, and this is how it was looked at. Despite physicians' valiant effort to combat diabetes, their patients remained little more than human guinea pigs, testing a variety of folk remedies. Then in 1921, something truly miraculous, earth-shattering, if you will, occurred in Ontario, Canada. A young surgeon, Frederick Banting, and his assistant, Charles Best, kept a severely diabetic dog alive for 70 days by injecting it with a murky concoction of canine pancreatic extract. In other words, this in its own way could be an enlightened and first development of evidence-based ethnomedicine. It wasn't pure as biomedical leaders now would like to see a single molecule, but you got to start somewhere, and that worked. With the help of Dr. Collip and Dr. McLeod, Banting and Best administered a more refined extract of insulin to Leonard Thompson, a young boy dying of diabetes. Within 24 hours, Leonard's dangerously high blood sugar dropped to nearly normal levels. Until the discovery of insulin, most children diagnosed with diabetes were expected to live less than a year. In a matter of 24 hours, the boy's life had been saved, and news of this virtual miracle went like wildfire throughout the world. I think the lesson we are learning, or we ought to learn from this, is in order to get to a single molecule which can be identified as being safe and efficacious, there are steps in the development. And in fact, this is where nutraceuticals come in today's world. Since insulin's discovery, medical breakthroughs continued to prolong and ease the lives of people with diabetes. In 1935, Roger Hinsworth discovered that there were two types of diabetes: insulin sensitive, which was called type 1, and insulin insensitive, which was described as type 2. By differentiating between the two types of diabetes, Hinsworth helped open up new avenues for the treatment of diabetes. And let me just very quickly identify some milestones in the development of the management of diabetes since that time. And I want to again reemphasize that real management of diabetes really started in the 1930s. It hasn't been a long, long time, yet the disease was identified over 2,000 years ago. So that's very, very important to note. And it takes time for drugs and systems to be developed to be very effective. Starting in the late 1930s, new types of pork and beef insulin were created to better manage diabetes. And when we say beef and pork, remember, it's coming from pigs and cows. In the 1950s, oral medications like the sulfonylureas were developed for people with type 2 diabetes. These drugs stimulate the pancreas to produce more insulin, helping people with type 2 diabetes keep tighter control over their blood sugars. Now, that's a major milestone there in terms of a drug which was produced for that specific purpose. In the 1960s, urine strips were developed for quick testing of diabetes. The first portable glucose meter was created only in 1969 by Ames. Since then, new and advanced technologies have brought us glucose meters the size of calculators that can be easily carried in a pocket or purse and can use programs in iPhones and other types of machines. In the late 1970s, the insulin pump was designed to mimic the body's normal release of insulin. The hemoglobin A1C test was devised only in 1979 in order to create a more precise blood sugar measurement. The innovations have gone on, and most of us are aware of many of the new ones that are available today. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, 3,000 years have passed since Aritia spoke of diabetes as the mysterious sickness. It has been a long and arduous process of discovery with several ethnomedical contributions, with generations of healthcare professionals such as physicians and scientists who have added their collective knowledge to finding a cure and have provided several biomedical management systems which have continued to make life easier. In other words, improving the quality of life of diabetes sufferers. We have Caribbean scientists and clinicians who have made significant contribution in the global fight against diabetes. And scientific breakthroughs in the prevention and management of diabetes have been studied throughout the Caribbean, leading institutions such as UWI and recently at UTEC with Professor Morrison's involvement there. And I would like to recognize some of the major pioneering clinicians and researchers who have contributed to the development of diabetes management systems. In other words, those clinicians and physicians who have helped to make a difference globally and locally. And I, as far as I'm concerned, and I'm sure most people will agree with me, that our own Professor Errol Morrison is globally recognized for his contribution. I ask you to join me in recognizing. And then Professor Morrison himself feels that, in his usual very humble way, he would not be number one, but there is a Professor Ralph Richards, a Trinidadian, who was the real father. But I think together, those have been very, very major. And of course, while those might be the physicians and clinicians who did so much in diabetes management development, we cannot forget our clinicians who in their own way made significant contributions. And I would like to single out at least two, and this is not all, but at least two, Dr. Don Christian and Dr. Knox Hagley, who has always been here with us. Ladies and gentlemen, we now need to look at the global and Caribbean epidemic burdens of diabetes, because when you get down to it, it is a burden in so many ways. And I felt it was important to touch on this, that the full impact and implications of diabetes can be recognized. The International Diabetes Federation estimates that over 366 million people currently live with diabetes. This accounts for 8.3% of the adult population and is projected to increase to near 552 million by 2030. Interestingly, and I would like you to note this, interestingly, over 80% of all persons living with diabetes are from developing countries like Jamaica and areas in the Caribbean. That is a tragedy, because this is where there are the problems of financial resources, proper nutrition, and I could go on. And one might ask, is that why it is so? That's a question which needs to be answered. Epidemiologic studies have revealed that the prevalence of diabetes in the English-speaking Caribbean range from 12.6 to 16.4, with Jamaica having over 400,000 cases and rapidly moving to 500,000 persons. That is significant and major and worrying in a population of approximately 3 million people. More recently, in 2011, the IDF estimated that one in every 10 adults in North America and the Caribbean region are suffering from diabetes. You'll note in this new slide that the socioeconomic impact of diabetes presents a high burden for individuals and the entire society. This burden is not only related to healthcare costs, but also to the indirect costs caused by loss of productivity from disability and premature mortality. Medical expenditures for people with diabetes are 2 to 3 times higher than for those persons affected with other diseases. Let me just repeat this, because sometimes we tend to gloss over these things. And when we come to support a conference like this, sometimes we don't really fully appreciate the impact and importance of being supporters of a program like this. And I'll repeat this. The medical expenditures for people with diabetes is between 2 to 3 times higher than for those affected with other diseases, including cancers and so on and so on. Now, that's food for thought. Studies done by the World Health Organization in 2003 reveal that the total cost attributed to diabetes for health care expenditure in the English-speaking Caribbean countries exceeds US$1 billion. Of which Jamaica accounts for almost half of the reported figure, totaling nearly half a billion dollars. It was also reported that the healthcare expenditure for the Spanish-speaking Caribbean countries was almost twice that of the English-speaking countries, amounting to over $2 billion. All these are referenced, but I won't worry to go into this. However, as this global diabetes epidemic continues to unfold, some experts have asked whether the war against diabetes is in fact being lost, because the harder we try, the worse the situation seems to become, but more anon. Even though the socioeconomic impact is catastrophic and overwhelming, it is never too late to implement adequate management strategies geared towards sustaining life and equally reducing and preventing any further global financial burden and suffering to diabetes sufferers. Increasing, in the next slide, you'll see that the increasing prevalence of diabetes and associated complications present significant socioeconomic, medical, and scientific concerns and challenges. On average, as you heard from the minister this morning, poor lifestyle choices, lack of exercise, high caloric intake, unhealthy meals, leading to obesity are some of the major root causes of the high prevalence of diabetes locally and globally, and must therefore be tackled with urgency. And the good thing is, or the good news is, they can be prevented. The American Diabetes Association reported in 2005 that persons affected by this dreadful disease suffer long-term complications of various sorts, which we are all aware of, and you'll see from the slides. Diabetes is also an important factor in accelerating the hardening and narrowing of the arteries, and so on and so on. I think you all know about these. However, the end result is that diabetes is a life-spoiling disease, and one that shortens life expectancy, if not properly managed. However, it is important to note that the etiology and paraphysiology of the disease are markedly different among patients and therefore dictates different prevention strategies, diagnostic screening, and treatment methods. This has now been fully established, and we need to know this, especially those of us who are here as practitioners. However, modern technologies and drugs for monitoring and managing hyperglycemia have made diabetes a more manageable chronic disease. And if you purchase the book, which is right at the back there, you will get a lot of information which you can share with your colleagues and friends and pass these out. And I think it's not because I am associated with the book and my other colleagues here, but this is like a handbook for know-how about diabetes and diabetes management. So lots of them are at the back. Get your copy today. Now, in the new slide, I want to mention here that the availability of appropriate nutritional and micronutrients are also very important for the management of diabetes, and I guess most of us know this. The utilization of the glycemic index concept, while it could be regarded as being relatively new, is an important matter which needs to be fully understood, because what it is really saying is that the low glycemic index foods are the ones we should be getting people to understand. And I think those of us who are practitioners in here need to focus that not only on those who are suffering from diabetes, but those out there who could be prone to diabetes, that they recognize this as being very important. The chronic metabolic disorders caused by diabetes can alter the nutritional status of the individuals. And a lot more of is said in the book and in other literature, so I won't worry to go into that. And now we come to the main event, which you have been waiting for. What am I going to tell you about plants in the treatment or management of diabetes? And on the slide, you will notice there that I have indicated that there are two groups of plants. Group one, which has undergone significant scientific studies, but have been parked on the shelves or have been nicely published in scientific journals and medical journals to some extent, but have never been taken further. And I'll come back to this in a moment, but I just want you to know that there are basically two groups. So that's group one. Group two are those plants which are still, as far as I'm concerned, in the folkloric domain. A lot of people will swear that they work, and I don't know, maybe they do, maybe they don't. But in today's practice of medicine, everything needs to be evidence-based for it to have scientific and medical acceptability. So we can't tell people that they must not, because whether, in fact, I shouldn't say that. We need to tell them, but we know that whether we tell them or not, in their cultural milieu and in their practices And for a number of other reasons, which I had touched on before, they're going to continue to use it anyway. But we, as practitioners, need to explain that there are dangers associated with this. And I'll just walk this through and come back to some of these points very quickly later on. Scholarly studies have demonstrated that the demand for herbal therapy is growing exponentially. I think it's important that we say this. And I'm really emphasizing this because sometimes we tend to poo-poo things. But the reality is people are using these things. And this is why I said earlier, physicians and healthcare professionals like nurses and everybody else need to recognize this is a reality and be educated so that when they're dealing with their patients, they can know what's going on. A lot of physicians will tell you that their patients don't even tell them that they use these things, but that's another matter, because that's where training and education will come in to know really what's going on. These studies have indicated that the growth in popularity in the use of herbal remedies is not only because herbal remedies are relatively inexpensive, but also because they form better, quote-unquote, cultural acceptability and, in a lot of cases, less recognized side effects, unlike many pharmaceutical drug agents. However, other studies have indicated that many herbal remedies have some side effects and may lead to drug interactions and may show little or no efficacy because there are no defined dosage levels or standards. It is for this reason that raw herbal therapies cannot be used as a substitute for conventional therapy, and that herbal remedies should not be viewed as an effective substitute for conventional drug agents such as oral hypoglycemics and insulin. I think I need to read this again because it's the message which we all have to take out there. Herbal therapy cannot be used as a substitute for conventional therapy, and that herbal remedies should not be viewed as an effective substitute for conventional agents such as oral hypoglycemics and insulin, because a lot of these herbal remedies that are being used are based on folklore and have no evidence-based data. Having said that, let me maybe take a minute or so to elaborate this a little bit. And I'm going to use one example of a herb which is being used like wildfire all over Jamaica and the Caribbean for that matter, and that is guinea hen weed. Guinea hen weed is now recognized, and you can't tell people anything else because they accept and believe. I've had literally hundreds of people who I've talked to in recent years who are firm believers. What is the truth behind it? I'll tell you in a second. However, the danger of people going out there and picking the bush and boiling it to make a tea has many dangers. What are some of these dangers? The root of the plant is where most of the bioactivity exists. And when you root it up, a lot of us don't realize that there are many pathogens, dangerous, serious pathogens in the soil. And they could be ingesting these pathogens without even realizing that they could cause other problems for their health care. That's just one. Many other issues. Two, a lot of people are, when they're reaping these herbs from the bushes or their gardens, are not aware that they could be pulling up other herbs with them because they're not fully aware. Some people are told what guinea hen looked like. Some of them will even tell you what it smells like. But there are other plants that smell like it too and look like it. So they're not sure what they're taking in, and they could be also making problems. And this is why and the next thing is the dosage. You'll hear some people say they pull up the guinea hen weed and they have a handful and a boil it. Some people tell you four handfuls, because as far as they are concerned, the stronger, the more bush you put in it and you boil and use it, the more effective it's going to be, which is of course nonsense. But these are issues which we as practitioners need to be aware of and help people to understand. Reaping herbs from the garden or out in the bushes and saying that it's effective is not the way to go. And it is for this reason why things like nutraceuticals have been developed, where the FDA has come into play and other governments to set standards where these herbs, and as far as the Biotechnology Institute, which I'm fully involved with, we decided that we wanted to make a difference, and we got these herbs that are in our nutraceuticals, which have been fully processed, fully FDA meeting the FDA standards of production and GMP standards and every standard which you can find in the United States. And in fact, we have even manufactured these products in the United States that they meet the full seal of approval. I think it's worth noting here that nutraceuticals is nothing new to the United States. In fact, it's a multi-billion dollar business. And people are using these where they're not, where there are no alternatives. However, nutraceuticals is more for health maintenance and wellness. And if you will, as you'll hear from Professor Davidson later, I'm sure he will mention some of these, so I won't go into any more details. However, many diabetic patients in the developed world cannot afford modern medicines or even nutraceuticals and the technologies which they need to manage their diabetes. Consequently, traditional healers, as well as individuals picking their own bush and using them, become the norm. Our newly published book, which was launched today, focuses on the most widely used Caribbean plants and folk remedies used for the treatment of diabetes management. An excellent discussion of these plants is provided. And the plants have been placed in two groups, as I told you, and group one represents a number, and I think you'll see what the group one plants look like in the next slide. The group one plants, there are six of them. And these six plants have been, I wouldn't say exhaustively studied, but studied to a very great extent. And our own Professor Morrison has been at the forefront of this, with Ralph Richards and others who have looked at these. Now, these plants have undergone scientific evaluation, and as far as I'm concerned, are now ready to go for clinical trials. But let me maybe be a bit audacious here and knock our own University of the West Indies. These six plants that you will note here have been looked at many years ago, some of them as far back as over 30 years. They have shown the scientific evidence that they are potential drug agents. But nobody has decided to take a look to see if there could be the need, if there's a need for more scientific evaluation and clinical studies. And I bet you, with the mounting demand for diabetes treatment, somebody either in the United States or Canada or Australia, which is now moving gung-ho on these issues, is going to come in and take this and make billions of dollars. I have never given up on telling everybody about what happened to us with the periwinkle, Vinca Rosa. And if Jamaica can't wake up and our own university can't wake up and realize we need to establish clinical trials there on looking at some of these things, I don't know. I don't want to bash UWI, but they got to wake up. And we will have to help them to wake up. What I want to say here is that for those who have not heard the story before, many of you have heard it, periwinkle, Vinca Rosa, was identified in Jamaica by a local physician when it was being used to treat diabetes. And it was found that it caused changes in the red blood, the white blood cell count. It was referred to colleague physicians in Canada, and they did further work and found out that this is a very, it has a bioactive molecules which would be very, very effective against leukemia. Today, Canada is reaping all the benefits. The last number I heard is that per milligram, it's about $5,000. It is the only plant, as far as the literature has stated, which is effective in treating childhood leukemia. We know about vincristine and vinblastine, which were isolated. We know about the biotransformation, and we know that it's being used to treat various cancers and other chronic diseases. We lost out on this because we weren't interested. What is even more tragic is that the Canadians took our periwinkle, got them developed, and planted out hundreds of thousands of acres in Madagascar and renamed periwinkle Madagascar periwinkle. So those are the two countries that are benefiting. And I gave the story, and I always give it, and those of us who are not willing to support local research and development and movement to clinical trials, we will always be people who are buying and importing, and we'll never be able to move forward. So we need to bear this in mind, and you, the audience, though you might think you have no power, this could be the start of people power to make this happen. Now, thank you. I thought you were sleeping. If you're really serious, let me hear it again. Good, good, thank you. I now move to group two. And I'm just giving some examples of group two, because remember, I mentioned these are folkloric and little or no scientific work has been done. And I just picked on some of these. These are plants used throughout the world. It's not just in Jamaica. But I don't believe we are ready for this. Now, having said this, the current research on the value of herbs and plant extracts for the treatment of diabetes is at best inconclusive because of what I said before. We need more scientific studies. We need more clinical or some clinical work on this. And until we get there, we are not in a position to say that we have plants which can and will do. We have evidence, scientific evidence, that a number of them can, but we need to go to the next level, as was done with periwinkle. No human clinical trials, which are the gold standards for demonstrating safety and efficacy of any therapy, have been performed on our herbal remedies used for diabetes currently, and they cannot currently be recommended as either a substitute or an adjunctive therapy for managing diabetes. So we are at the point where, I repeat, we're at the point where we have six potential drug candidates. We know what many of the bioactive molecules are, but we have not taken them to the next level. Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, what is the way forward? The future of diabetes management will be based on continuing innovation through scientific research and development. One area of R&D focus should be the development of new products as a stepping stone towards our drugs through nutraceuticals, while we work hard to identify scientifically the products which will lead to drug candidates. We have clearly demonstrated that there are eight plans ready for further scientific work. The question is, are we ready to put resources in this to move forward, or are we willing to let other nations take these and do the necessary R&D and commercialization? We are the only ones who can make this decision. It has been stated that a major factor impeding the development of medicinal plant-based industries in the Caribbean countries is a lack of information on social and economic benefits that could be derived from this type of development. Except for the use of these plans for local folklore healthcare needs, not much information has been available on either their market potential, their healthcare efficacy, their market potential, or the information needed to take the necessary scientific and clinical work forward. As a result, the governments and entrepreneurs have not exploited the potential of these plans. Therefore, the way forward for Jamaica and the rest of the CARICOM region is evidently clear. It is time for the government and the private sector to realize the importance and economic potential of investing in science and technology for wealth creation, starting with our own local medicinal plants, where the end result is growth in their respective countries. The translation of these groundbreaking scientific findings from indigenous plants must be embraced and aggressively pushed towards the development of novel products, either as nutraceuticals, cosmeceuticals, or pharmaceuticals. All this will translate to the overall improvement in the financial growth, as well as health and wellness of the Caribbean people. In addition to identifying plants which can be exploited for their medicinal value, there's a great need for highly trained professionals who are required to design, develop, and administer the studies. And if we want to go to complementary or alternative care, they need to be full professionals who can assist physicians and other healthcare workers in this regard. It is therefore noteworthy to highlight the fact that the University of Technology in Jamaica has launched a new academic program in herbal studies and complementary alternative medicine. But while I'm aware that a lot of work is being done now to move all of this forward, it must be on evidence base. Otherwise, you won't get the health professionals taking it seriously. This is the first university in the Caribbean region to offer these programs, for which UTEC should be commended. I'm going to ask you to join me in commending them. This new development will, to a great extent, support the development of a cadre of qualified personnel who can assist not only with the safe practices, standards, and quality control, but with the necessary R&D skills to take these ethnomedical practices to the next level. It is hoped that as a result of these developments, a registry of these professionals, these new emerging professionals, can be accredited by the Ministry of Health to work in the region. Nevertheless, experiences from the years of traditional uses can often provide us with useful guidelines. And I have been given my signal that I need to wrap up, and I want to say here that currently 80% of the world's population depend on plant-derived medicines as the first line of primary health care for alleviation of their health problems. It should be noted that plants are important sources of medicine, and presently about 25% of all pharmaceutical prescriptions in the United States, at least, are there. I want to also mention that all of Asia, 70% of all therapy is based on herbs, and that includes Japan, which is a first world country. Ladies and gentlemen, we believe that we have the opportunity of moving forward and doing a lot more, and we need to support evidence-based R&D as we move forward to create wealth from our indigenous resources. Thank you.